Okay, good afternoon, all of you. I welcome all in the day 3, session 3 of Faculty Development Program. It is a RTU TechWeb 3 sponsored faculty development program on blockchain and its application running from 15 September to 19 September, jointly organized by Rajasthan Technical University Kota and Department of Computer Engineering, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology, Jaipur, Rajasthan. I welcome you all in the session 3. The session 3 detail I'd like to tell you. That session 3 topic is Message Digest for Blockchain. The timing of the session will be 2 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. I'd like to welcome our expert speaker. I'd like to introduce expert speaker, Dr. Manoj Kumar, sir. Dr. Manoj Kumar, sir, is a professor of the Delhi Technological University. Sir is the head of Computer Center, Delhi Technological University. Sir is the in charge of Computer Service Center of the Rajasthan Technical University. Sir have conducted various training programs for administrative staff for the Rajasthan Technical University and Vardhman Mahavir Kota Open University. Sir is the author of the book titled Data Structure Through C and the study material of some courses of Vardhman Mahavir Kota Open University. Sir is a vice chairman, BTech admission of the Delhi Technological University and managing JAC Delhi Counseling. Sir has published more than 30 research papers in various conferences and international journals. I welcome, sir. Please share your precious knowledge and make us comfortable in the topic of the blockchain. Sir, please.
Thank you, Rakhi. Apna presentation off kar dijiye aap.
Yes, sir.
I'll share my screen.
Yes, sir.
Now, is it visible?
Yes, sir, it is properly visible, sir.
And my voice clear?
Yes, sir, your voice is very clear, sir.
Okay. So, we have many algorithms for message digest, or we call it simply hashing. Hashing and message digest are basically very popular in field of cryptography. Normally we use it for a digital signature or message authentication and message integrity, and main use we are using as a password verification. So I'll discuss some password verification also when I go ahead. So hashing is what you can say. I can give a real life example. Suppose I say you have a hostel and you want to allocate hostel to students. Okay, and normally students are having choices of rooms, room numbers, and suppose 100 rooms are there, 100 students are there. What to do? And you want to randomize this task. What I can do, I can prepare a database of students, their basic details like roll number, their name, date of birth, something like this. So these records I prepare for each student. And I feed these records to a, you can say, mathematical function, which generates a room number between 1 to 100. Okay. So every time if I feed a number or detail of one student to that software will generate same room number always. So it, you can say, a record which contains student data is converted mathematically into a small number range between 1 to 100 only. So this process, you can say, this is hashing. So hashing is simply a mathematical function. So what it is doing is converting a plain text. Plain text may be very long, very small, only one bit may be there, or thousand bits are there, or million, billions of bits may be there. So it's converting that plain text into a hash text. Hash text, you can treat them a number or you can treat them as a text. So this will be a big number. Suppose we need 128-bit hash, so output of hash function will be 128-bit. So why we take 128-bit or why we take 256-bits as a hash size, that also I'll discuss. That is related to security. So these functions, when we are mapping some input to some output, and output range is very limited normally. Just I gave the example of hostel, only 1 to 100. But in the case of computer, suppose I say output is a 10-bit number, then total 1024 different hashes will be there. You feed any input text, your hash value will be between 0 to 1023. So means if we are having more than 1024 varieties of input text, then definitely two texts will be having same hash value. So all the hash function or message digest functions are having some characteristics. These are, one is deterministic. Deterministic means every time you feed the same input, it will generate the same output. Same hash value will be generated. That I gave example of hostel room allotment. Every time you feed particular student record, it will generate same room number. So it is deterministic, not randomized algorithm. Then quick computation. Because input may be very, 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 very large, may contains something like whatever data you are having on Facebook currently, that may be the size of input. Okay, some petabytes or something like that. So computation should be fast. Within seconds or within minutes, we should get the hash value. And if you go through construction of these hash algorithms, you will realize these hash functions or hash algorithms are using very basic computations. Those computations are directly available in processor instruction set. Like you want to perform XOR, you want to perform bitwise AND. Okay, you want to add two numbers. Okay, all these are basic functions, and each processor is having these basic instructions. So implementation of these hash functions or message digest functions are very easy. If you program it in assembly language directly, you can program it in assembly language, because all basic processor instructions are there. Or you can design a hardware, like a chip you can design, which will be, you feed input from one side and it will generate output. And it can have some pipeline architecture so that some computation may be done in parallel or in sequence. So quick computation is another requirement. So we cannot wait for hours for generating a particular hash. Then third requirement is pre-image resistance. Like I gave example of hostel. Suppose I have hostel, I cannot find out student data. It should be difficult to find out student data. Okay, means reverse conversion. You are having the hash value. From given hash value, can we generate the input text? No. This process is not reversible. It's only one-way process. The input text will be converted into hash function, hash value. But from hash value, you cannot find out the input text. It's very, very difficult. So that property should be there for sake of security. And then for every input, we should have different hash. If you change even 1 bit of hash, 1 bit of input, you will see entire hash will change. Entire hash will change. I'll show you demo also today. So I'll change only single bit of input and entire hash will change. Then collision resistance means two inputs should not have same hash value. Otherwise problem will be there, especially in case of blockchain, because all the blocks are being identified using hash values. So if two blocks are having same hash value, it will become a problem, because hash values are basically pointers to blocks, we can say, in the blockchain. So one particular hash value is pointing to two blocks, so ambiguity will be there. So this is not possible normally. So we take suitable number of bits in hash value, so that this becomes very rare. Like for two inputs or two blocks of blockchain, we are having same hash value. This is impossible. One application of hashing or message digest is your password. What do you think when you log in onto some account, like on Twitter, you are typing your login ID and typing your password and pressing the login button? What's happening? Your user ID is going, username is going to server, your passwords may be going to server, and server will be having some stored file of password, and this password will be matched with the stored password, and matching is there. You are allowed the access, but this is not happening, because if we are storing password file on server and password file is compromised, all the passwords will be leaked. What is system here? This hash of password or message digest of password is stored in password file. So if password file is stolen, attacker will be able to see only hash value of password, not the actual password. And I said this reverse is not possible. From given hash value, he cannot construct the password. So definitely he won't be able to know your password. And remember, when you forget your password and send some request to reset your password, normally all the servers, they say you reset your password. They won't tell you the password normally. Why? Because they also don't know your password. They are only having their hash value. So this hash function is computed for your password on your client machine normally. When your login page is there, that login page will be having some hidden software, program. That will be computing the hash value, and only hash value transmitted on internet normally. So from over ABC123 password, a long hash value 256 bit hash value may be there. Okay, and this hash value is basically stored in database, and that has received hash value and stored hash value will be matched. Now one more question comes here. Suppose you are having a habit of having same password on different sites, isn't it? Same password on different sites. So suppose I am a attacker, I get access to this password file of two different sites, and I see your hash value is same on both the sites, and somehow I get your password of one site, then I can simply guess that your password is same for this site also. So what they do, if you are creating the same password for different websites and web servers, but in password file, the hash value will be different. To make it different, suppose same hash function is being used everywhere. Normally standards are there, MD5 is being used for generating hash value of password. What we do, what every site is doing, along with password, they are adding some salt value. Okay, so password combined with salt value will be fed to hash algorithm, and then hash value will be generated, and this will be stored in your password file at server side. So including the salt here, random salt here, okay, will, if you are keeping same password here, different sites will be having different salt values for you, for your password, and your stored hash value will be different, just to confuse your attackers. So that is application of hash value in this authentication area, but we have to deal with the blockchain. So today I'll discuss two hashing algorithm, and all other hashing algorithm, so many hashing algorithms are being used in blockchains, but mostly those algorithms will be based on these two algorithms. So basic idea remains same, their parameters may change, some states may change, number of rounds may change, there some constant values may change. And one more problem is there. I talked about collision, means two input values are creating same hash value. That should not happen. So just see how big this problem is and how to avoid this. Problem is popularly known as birthday paradox. suppose you are having we are in this meeting, I think we are having around 70-80 persons. Yes. Suppose I do one experiment just now. I ask everyone his date of birth, not the year, only day and month. Okay, what is the probability that two persons in this meeting group are having same birthday? Having same birthday. If I assume that chances of having birthday, every day can be birthday of a person, then chances of two persons are having same birthday will be only 0.27. Okay, 1 by 365 is probability of person getting born on particular day. So now if we do the experiment, if around 23 persons are there in this meeting and I ask birthday of every person, 0.5 probability is there that two persons will be having same birthday. And if more than 23 persons are there, probability will increase further. If you are having 30 persons, probability may reach around 80%. So there will be 80% chance that out of 30 persons only, two will be having same birthday. Here only 365 different birthdays were there, and out of 365, suppose I have 366 persons, then you can say definitely two persons will be having same birthday. But here birthday paradox is, even if you have 53 persons in the room, two persons getting the same birthday, these chances are around 50%, and this chance will increase as we increase number of persons. So similar thing may happen in hashing also. Means if we take that, if we say only 365 different hash values are possible, then if we are having 366 different types of text, two texts will be having same hash value. So this, if I calculate, if you are having 128 bit hash value, which has 2^128 different possibilities, then by using birthday paradox, you have 50% of chances to break the collision resistance at √2^128. √2^128 is 2^64. Means if you are having 2^64 different types of text, 2^64 different types of text, if you are having, then there are 50% chances that two texts will be having same hash value. And just see this figure, 2^64. It's a very big number. We can make it still larger. If you are having 256 bit hash, this figure will become 2^128. Means after generating 2^128 different messages, more than this much, definitely two messages will be having same hash value. So if we take more number of bits in hash value, then chances of collision will reduce definitely, because according to the birthday paradox, you need around 2^64 different messages, and chances are only 50% that two messages will be having same hash value. So just to reduce this chance, we take longer hash value. So I think 128 bit is also enough, but nowadays faster computers are there and moving towards quantum computing, where many tasks can be performed in parallel. So 256 bits are normally enough. So I'll discuss two algorithms today, and both algorithms are having 256 bit hash. Now we come to blockchain one, how hash value will be used in blockchains. You must have attended 2 days lectures, so many things will be clear. So I'll discuss something related to hash only. So blockchain is basically a linked list. These blocks are linked using hash values. So block one means block two will be having hash value of previous block. Block three will be having hash value of previous block. And these hash values are basically your pointers. Mostly computer science faculties know about linked list. So hash value will be a usage block addresses basically. Okay. So some sort of linked list is there. And here at bottom, I have discussed Merkle roots. And below that, some tree type structure will be there. So this structure will be helping you searching a block. Suppose you are having you want to find out a block where it is located. okay, and you want to do something with that block. So if you are having hash value, means you are having address of that block. So using hash value, you want to search the particular block, then this Markel root and that associated tree will help you. So in block header, in blockchain, block header contains previous hash value, timestamp, then TX root, nonce, etc. And this TX root is basically your previous one, this one, Markel root basically. So that root will be having a tree type structure here. Okay. And that tree type structure, I'll explain later on, this one. This tree type structure will help you searching a particular hash value. So suppose you are having a hash value less than hash value stored here, you go left or you go right. Then again, you compare with the stored hash, you go left or right, and finally you reach the particular block. So something like this you can do using this Markel tree. So hashing is basically helping you searching a particular block in blockchain, because very large number of blocks are there in blockchain. Now we come to some hash functions. I have two algorithms today, SHA-256, which will generate one output of 256 bit hash. And this is currently used in Bitcoin network. And we have KCHAK-256, which also generates 256 bit hash. And this is popularly used in a popular Bitcoin, that is Ethereum, okay, popular this currency. So these two algorithms, they are having quite different structure. And so we'll discuss the first SHA-256. This is from SHA family. Okay. So in the beginning, SHA-1 came, then SHA-2, then later on, different versions are like SHA-256, SHA-512 also came into market. So SHA-256 was successor of SHA-1, means normally architecture remains same. How hash is calculated, how hash is generated, that remains same. Only parameters and size of hash and number of rounds and functions performed in each rounds may differ. Now SHA-256, this can hash a message whose length is up to 2^64 bits. Means that is 2.3 exabyte or 2.3 billion gigabytes can be transferred into digest of size 256. Means you can have a file size of this much, and that file size will be hashed to a number that is 256 bit long or 32 byte long. 32 bytes hongi, kuch aur hongi. So SHA-256 is basically is mapping all the messages. Message may contain only one bit, message may contain two bits, message may contain 2^64 bits. So all these messages get mapped to a hash value of size 256 only. So any message M will be hashed to H, H size is 256, and message size is 1 bit to 2^64 bits. So first task, if you are having an input message, what we need to do here, this SHA-256 is working on block size of 512 bits. So your whatever input you are feeding should be multiple of 512 bits. So if you are having a random message, to make it multiple 512 bits, we need to append some padding bits, and then add length also. That length of message is 64 bits. Okay, so this message part, that is L bit long, this length is represented, written in 64 bits as L. So message plus 64 bit plus padding, that will be the total length of input. So message plus padding plus 64 bit length combined should be multiple of 512 bits. N into 512 bit will be this total size of input. So input contains message plus some padding, and padding pattern is fixed, one followed by all zeros. Why we take one and then all zeros? Why don't we take all zeros here? You may ask this question. Okay. So what happens if you take all zeros here? Okay. And suppose message is having also, is this message part is also having all zeros? Message part is also having all zeros. Then whatever be the message size, like message containing only 3 bits, message containing 10 bits, your complete pattern, that is multiple of 512 bits, will be same. If this padding, this padding remains same, and same hash value will be generated. So to avoid that, we put a single one here, because this part will be processed by your hash function in some later stage. So we'll force hash for different inputs. So suppose you are having a parent message, original message also you can compute for last for 64 bits. You just remove edge and treat it as length, and then from starting you just take L bits you're learning the message. Then in pre-processing part, other padding, your message is now multiple of 512. So now make chunks of 512 bits. I create M1, M2, up to MN. The each block is 512 bit long, and in each block I can again have total 16 numbers of 32 bits. So I, my block is 512 bit, and smaller, this, these green blocks are basically 32 bit. So these 32 bit blocks will be used when we apply algorithm, hashing algorithm. So basic computation unit in this SHA-256 will be 32 bit numbers. So these input blocks will be processed separately, will be treated separately during computation of hash. This is complete overview of SHA-256. We are having input message, that is N into 512 bit long, including padding and length. Okay. Then just divide it into 512 bit chunks. First message will become M1, then M2, then MN, something like this. And then we will be having some initialization vector IV. Okay. This will be 256 bit long. So this IV is 256 bit long. What we do here, the first 512 bit is fed to a function whose inputs are this M1 and this IV. This will process and generate another 256 bit number. That will become input to next stage. Okay, so in next stage, we are feeding M2, we are processing next block of message M2, and so on. So finally, when we process all message blocks M1, M2, M3, up to MN, the final output will be your hash value, that will be 256 bit long. So what we need to know here, what is happening in each processing here? What happens here? This F function. So that initialization vector, I can, that is 256 bit long, I can denote it using 8 32-bit numbers, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. And this is starting value H, this one in hexadecimal I have given it. So, and these are basically derived from square root of first 8 prime numbers. If you come compute the square root of first 8 prime numbers, and after decimal points, your the digits are there or bits are there. Suppose you are performing in binary. So from that bit pattern, you pick 32 bits and you assign it to A. So square root of 2, square root of 3, square root of 5, square root of 7, 11, square root of 13, like this. So these are not fixed. Basically, these are generated from, generated mathematically. So these are the first, means that 256 bit value that will be fed here, HIV input. Okay. So we are feeding 256 bit number, and finally 256 bit output will be generated here. After that, we need 64K values, K0 to K63. These are also basically mathematically generated, but I've given a table here. So each K value is also 32 bit number. I told you this SHA-256 is basically doing 32 bit calculations. So any 32-bit processor can easily implement this algorithm. Now, after this, we have our installation is okay, like our padding is done, length is added, padding is added, you are having multiple blocks of 512 bits and you just slice them to create message blocks M1, M2, M3 up to MN, okay? And you have installation vector, that is IV, that is we call it A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, 8 values of 32 bit each. Now we are ready for doing the processing of each block. So that is done using compression function. So this is what is happening in when we process each block. So each message block is 512 bit long. We take that message block, and from that message block, we have to generate 64 words, W0, W1, W2, W3, up to W63. And we are already having K values, K0 up to K63. So these W values we have to generate. So message is 512 bit. So this contains, I think, 16 words of 32 bits. So W0 to W15 will be just generated using this 512 bit number, just divided into 32 bit chunks. And first chunk will become W0, second chunk will be W1, third will be W2, and so on. So up to W15 you can generate directly. Starting from W16 to W63, we are having a formula. Okay. We are having a formula. So to process 512 bit message block, we have to perform 64 rounds, round 1 to round 64. In each round, we are having input WI and KI in round I plus 1. And this output, see, this final output of round 64 will be a output for next message chunk. So definitely, if you are processing 32-bit numbers here, each round will be generating 32-bit number that may become input of next round, okay, and so on. So final round also generates a 32-bit number. So how we take that 32-bit number and process next block, that we'll learn next. So W0 to W15 is clear, I think. This is taken from message block, means message 512 bit message block divided into 16 blocks, and you construct W0 to W15. And from W16 to W63, this is the formula. WI is equal to WI minus 16, means from previous W we generate W16 to W63, plus row 0 and plus WI minus 7 plus row 1, where each row is also defined. So this everything is derived from previous blocks. This rotate write, ROTR, is rotate function that is available in any processor. XOR operation is also available in any processor. Rotate write, XOR, shift write. So rotate, shift, XOR, and this addition will be modulo 2^32 addition. Means last carry bit, you add 32-bit number, last carry you discard. So that is modulo 32-bit addition. So like this, you generate all W's, W0 to W63, and then we go ahead. Now we are having 64 W values and 64 K values, and we have to perform 64 rounds to process 512-bit block. That happens like this. We were having A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, our 256-bit input. So some processing is done, like we are having a CH function, which is taking input E, F, and G and generating something that is added with something with H. And here we are adding WT and KT, that like W0 and K0 will be added. Here that input will come here, will be added here, or something like this. So all these functions are defined here. And you can see here, in CH functions also, we are having bitwise AND operation, bitwise XOR operation, bitwise NOT operation, bitwise AND operation, shift operation. All these operations are available in microprocessor or your processor. All these are processor instructions. So implementing this algorithm in assembly language becomes easier. So every plus is your addition modulo 2^32, I explained. So finally, when you process like this, okay, you generate a 32-bit number here. I said you generate a 32-bit number. That 32-bit number will go to A, and all these input will be shifted. A will be copied to B, B will be copied to C, and this will become your next input for next 512-bit block processing. Okay, so when you process one first 512-bit block, the initialization vector A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H will be processed and will be generating a new A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, where previous A becomes current B, previous B becomes current C, and so on. And your processing output, that was 32-bit number, will replace A. So every time, this A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H will change after every round. Okay? So like this, if you keep on processing every block, M1, M2, up to MN, last block when you process and output A, B, C, D is generated, that is your final hash value. And this will be your 256-bit hash value. So final output will be your 256-bit. If I take one example here, I have one demo here. I have a program which is computing hash value. Okay, suppose I have a file. paste1.txt. Just see the content. What is the content? I have written 1111. This is not binary. This is basically ASCII characters. So this file is there. If I process it, I am having a program to compute SHA-256. So this program will run and this file will be the input. This file is very small, but let's see. This is the hash value generated. Let's see. If I feed another hash value generated. Now I'll just give you one example, like type paste4.txt. You can see this contains only single character A, and my file paste5 contains B. ASCII A and ASCII B, only one bit differs. So input, I am changing only one bit in input, and just see two different hash values. Entire hash value will change. I am changing only one bit of input, entire hash will change. Let's see. First I'll generate for test 4. This is the hash value. And for test 5, this is the hash value. And this is entirely different. Just see, test 4 hash value 559AE. This is DF7E70, something like this. So entire hash is changing. Even if you are changing only single bit in input, that is property of that last property I discussed. Okay, fourth property I discussed. Okay, means you change only one bit or few bits, entire hash will change. That is desired property of hash. Otherwise, you'll be able to relate that I am changing this bit, so these two bits of hash value will change. Something like that you can relate, and from one hash value you can derive another hash value. So now I again continue. Now we move to another algorithm, and that is having entirely different concept of generating hash. This is basically, we call it SHA-3 and Kachak. Though both algorithms looks quite similar, but if I run the program, I will show you demo also, both generates a different hash value because their parameters are different. Okay. Algorithm wise, if you see processing of SHA-3 and Kachak, it's entirely same. But finally, they are different algorithm. What happened basically, NIST started a competition to find better successor to SHA-2 algorithm. And in that competition, one team participated. One particular team won that competition, and they suggested Kachak algorithm. Kachak hashing algorithm. Then they won the prize and NIST adopted Kachak, and then they designed, just changed some specification of Kachak, and they designed SHA-3 and released it as standard hashing algorithm. So both algorithms look similar. So I'll discuss SHA-3 here, that is quite similar to Kachak. So this is basically based on that sponge. We can say concept of sponge. Sponge is what? If you pour water on a sponge, it will absorb water. It won't increase its size. It will just keep on absorbing water. When enough water is absorbed, now if you squeeze, water will be released and sponge size will be reduced. So we are having absorption phase, absorbing phase and squeezing phase. In observing phase, input bits will be absorbed into something. Okay, we keep on processing input blocks M1, M2, M3, etc., and all those bits will be absorbed into your pattern. Okay, that initialization vector, something like that. So you can see here input message you are giving. You are applying padding here. Then after padding, message becomes multiple of something. Then you divide that message into equal chunks like P0, P1, P2, etc. up to PN-1. And every block you process separately. And when you are processing it, what is input here? A vector which is divided into two parts, R and C. And this R and C, this R becomes input of processing R and P. On R and P, we apply some function. On R and P, we apply some function, we generate something, and again, this input and this C directly going to this function F. Then this function F is basically a combination of five functions. So those five functions are applied in a particular sequence to generate the output, and one stage is over. In one stage, these two vertical blocks are there. And then again, that output will be mixed with P1. And again, we generate that F1. So this output from this F will be again divided into R and C. And that R and C will be processed here with P1 to generate this output and so on. Finally, this absorbing phase will be over, because this phase is absorbing P0, P1, P2, up to PN-1. But this input, that is R plus C, that size remains same. So in particular sponge, we are absorbing P0, P1, P2, etc., and our pattern size remains same. Okay. And finally, we move into the final output will be divided into R and C, and then we move into a squeezing block. Squeezing means now we have to compress it and generate the desired size hash value. This may have, suppose this is having 2000 bit number and our hash is 256 bits. So out of this, just extract 256 bit, that will be your final hash. So that is your compression or squeezing part. So absorbing and squeezing, these two phases are there in this algorithm, and that is the main property of this family of algorithm, SHA-3 or Kachak. And one more beauty of this algorithm is there, you can have, I call a family of algorithm, means different size of hash values can be generated using same algorithm. You just change the parameters and you will have different size of hash. So how those parameters are selected, you can see. So Kachak provided this idea. So Kachak calculates the state size. State size is nothing but 25 into b to the power l, where b is state size value of l. That is your 0 to 6, you can take any value, and the corresponding B value will be 25, 50, 100, 200, 400, 800, and 1600. So for SHA-3, see, this Kachak suggested an entire family, and SHA-3 was basically another family that is based on Kachak. So they selected the value 6 here. Then when they selected value 6 here, the sixth value here, 1600, is taken as B. Okay. So if you select these parameters, number of round is decided by L. Okay. So L was 6 here, and B was 1600, according to this Kachak parameters. So rounds will be 12 plus 2 into L. That is 12 plus 2 into 6, 12 plus 12. Total 24 rounds will be there for our selected parameter. L is 6. So 24 rounds in total will be there in each step of hashing. And now we got the information that state size will be 1600 bits and number of rounds will be 24 bits. These two parameters are now decided. Now we can move ahead. Again, say I said SHA-3 is a family of algorithm. So SHA-3 is having different versions. Like you can have 224-bit hash, you can have 256-bit hash, you can have 384-bit hash, you can have 512-bit hash. So four different versions are there in SHA-3. Output length is according to number written here, 224, 256, and so on. Your R value will be 1152. Now we need two values here, R and C. If you remember my previous slides, here we need R and C. So that pattern will be 1600 bit long. This R plus C combined will be 1600 bit long. So each vertical block here is 1600 bit long, that is divided into two parts, R and C. So that R and C value is defined here for different versions of SHA-3. 1152 plus 448, total is 1600. Again, 1088 plus 512, again 1600 bits. So total of R and C will be 1600. So you select any version. Total number of bits you are processing in each round will be 1600. So now, again here, padding is required. So the padding need to be done in a such a way that after padding, the length of padded message is exactly multiple of R. So if we are going for SHA-256, it should be multiple of 1088 bits. Okay. So depending on version selected, you will select the this block size also, and accordingly your number of padding bits will change. The sum of value of R and C will always be 1600. That is the condition here. Total of R and C is 1600. Here, padding pattern is different. Earlier, you have seen in SHA-256, padding pattern was 1 followed by all zeros. Here, one, first bit and last bit will be 1, and in between those ones, all bits will be 0. So 1, 0, 0, 0, all 0, then last will be 1. So that is the padding pattern here. After padding, again, what we do, we divide into n blocks of messages, depending on our version selected. Suppose SHA-256, we divide that input message plus padding into chunks of 1088 bits and then process every chunk of 1088 bits in particular round. So our state size was 1600 bits, that is divided into R and C. R was containing 1088 bits and remaining bits were there in C. If I talk about SHA-3-256, or we call it Kachak-256 also, though both are different, but almost all the parameters are same, some values are different. Now fjob function. So you have the message, you did the padding, and after padding the message was multiple of some, suppose 1088 bits, and that message is divided into 1088 bit blocks. Okay, so you are having this P0 will be 1088 bit, and the R will be 1088 bits. Okay, so now this R size and P0 size is equal, so we can do this addition here simply. After doing this addition, we apply the function F, which is combination of 5 functions listed here. So I need not go into details of each function, but I have given formulas. Those formulas are quite similar to what we used in SHA-256. Simple XOR operation, ending operation, NOT operation, okay, and addition modulo something. So after doing this, the last output generated from here, last output generated will be having 1600 bits, and that will be having R and C part. R and C part. Clear? So this is basically just absorbing P0 here, absorbing P1 here, absorbing P2, etc. So final absorbing Pn minus 1. After absorbing Pn minus 1, your output will be 1600 bit number, which is can be divided into C and R. That 1600 bit number goes into a squeezing round. So the squeezing function begins immediately after we reach the end of absorb function. Absorb function end means we are processing last block of input message, padded input message. So this is called a squeeze function because in this step we extract our hash message. What will be hash? Because we are having 1600 bits. So the way in which we extract it, extremely simple and easy to understand. Just see, from this 1600 bit R and C, we just take this 1600 bit and then perform a squeeze function and generate Z. Z will be your final hash value. So when calculating the hash value, we already know output length of hash value might be 224, 256, 384 or 512 bit. Your R was having 1088 bits roughly if I take one version. So for SHA-3 256, R was having 1088 bits. So out of 1088 bits, we just select 256 bits here. Just select 256 bit number and that will be your final hash. Okay, so we just segregate the output on the basis of length of R and C bits depending on the hash value we are trying to calculate, which lead us to output. So just take first 256 bit numbers from R, just cut 256 bit numbers here, that will be your final hash value. So this was your simple squeeze function. You have to just extract 256 bit for 256 bit hash or 384 or 512 or 224 bits depending on your algorithm you are using. So for this also I have a demo. You want to experiment with hash value or you want to just check hash values, you go to this site. I mentioned in my PPT that I'll share. Just see here, Keshak, you type your input here, it will immediately generate. Suppose I type A, it will generate the hash value here. Okay, I'm just keep on typing. Every typing will change the hash value. Hash value size is always constant here. So just you can see here also, if I make input A, you can see hash is starting with 037. If I change it to B, hash is entirely changed. 1F6, something like this. Same thing, you are having all the algorithm mentioned here. So you can test here, like this is Kachak 256. For A, it was generating 037. Okay. I take SHA-3 256. Type A. This hash is different. So SHA-3 256 and your Kachak 256, both are not same. Both are different here, remember. Though algorithm wise, they look quite similar, their processing is entirely same. Some parameters are different, that's why they are generating different hash values here. So here you can experiment all algorithm, popular algorithms are here, list of algorithm, like you can generate CRC also, you can generate MD2, MD4, MD5, these are also popular hashing algorithms. Normally MD5 is very popular in Java package or any other like Python also. You'll find these built-in functions in library. So you call those functions, they will generate your hash values. So this is normally used for storing the password, hash of password. Okay. So all popular functions are here. The normally you see after MD5 family, you are having only SHA family here. Different versions of SHA. Okay. And then different versions of Kachak algorithm here. Okay. Then these are encoding. So Shake algorithm is also popular. It's being used in blockchain. So most popular, I have discussed two only, SHA and Kachak. And Kachak is very much closely related to SHA-3. So SHA-3, all versions are here, SHA-3 224, 256, 384, 512. Okay. So this is the hashing function. This this column contains file hash. Suppose you want to feed input file here, you can select this one, SHA-3 to 356 for file. Then you have to drop a file here. Any file you can drop here now, any EXE file, any image file, anything you can drop here, it will just compute the hash function here.
Sir, could you please share this link to chat box? The link of this website, can you please share in chat box?
Okay, I'm just doing it. Well, you want to experiment just now, and you can experiment. Okay. Then if we move ahead.
Okay, thank you, sir. So we can also create such like a hash.
Yeah, I told you there was a competition by NIST. So if you study several hash functions or hash algorithms, then you can plan for your own hash function. Okay, your own hash algorithm. But okay. To get it accepted worldwide, you need to prove that this meets all the requirements. All the requirements. Like you are changing one bit of input text, entire hash is changing. It is fast to compute. Okay? It's collision resistance. Every property should be there. Then only it can become popular. And when this is being used in Bitcoins and these currencies, then another things are also there, like Bitcoins and other these currencies are having some puzzles based on hashing. So your algorithm should be compatible enough to create those puzzles. Okay. So finally, I'll just list some of the algorithms used for cryptocurrency. SHA-256 is popular because of Bitcoin. Then your ETHAS, yeah, Ethereum was using this algorithm, ETHAS. Scrypt is there, Equihash is there, Cryptonite is there, X11 is there. And if you see the different cryptocurrencies, SHA-256 is being used in so many currencies here. These are very popular currencies, cryptocurrencies. Then ETHAS, first suggested by Ethereum. So then Ethereum Classic, then Kodak Coin, Ubiq, then Scrypt is there. Then Equihash is there. Zcash is also popular, this cryptocurrency. Zcash, Zcoin, okay. Bitcoin Gold. Then Cryptonite hashing algorithm is again being used here. And remember, normally in blockchains, suppose you are using some software to trade cryptocurrencies, then your software should be compatible with current version they are using. Okay? So blockchains ke bhi versions create ho gaye hain aapke. Like har ek cryptocurrency jinke associated software hain aapke, to wo versions par work kar rahe hain. So normally in block also, in blockchain, every block stores version number also, so that if you are accessing the old block of blockchain, then your algorithm will just tune it with old version. Okay, so some of your algorithm may change. So any other questions by audience you want to ask related to hashing?
Could you please share this presentation, sir?
Yeah, presentation I'll send you directly to you, Rocky. okay?
Okay.
Then you can share it with participants, okay?
Yes. Sir, were there any authenticate site for this particular protocol? Like, if we want to learn, like SHA, there is any authenticate official site?
Official, if you can search some, I think medium something was there to learn this. I'll just
there we have several algorithms like SHA, PATCHAK.
One minute. I'll just find out from my history. I have searched something. Yeah, one link I'm sharing. This site is having many popular hashing algorithms described in better way. Just I'll share it here. Yeah, Rakhi, this link also you can try to learn about various hashing algorithms. Very good site. Complete detail you'll find, bit to bit detail you'll find in this site. Okay, I have taken most of the material from this site.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So this is also a good site to learn about any hash function. Any hash function, use this site. Okay, Rakhi, thank you. Nothing is there. Questions, hai kuch? Comment mein to koi questions nahi hai.
I request any of the participant, if you have any query, you can please place your queries. Okay, thank you, sir. This is really
okay,
very
okay.
This session is really like research oriented, and one can, if you want to do the research on this area, there is really a simulating. You have given some way to simulate the things also. Sir, could we communicate further if we have some query regarding
this? Yeah.
So in your presentation there will any like contact any email message like
I think you have my email address.
Okay. So could I share these email address to participants?
Yeah. Even on my website email address is public. Okay.
Yes, your website is also there. Yes, sir. Okay. I'll share that website also.
Okay. Thank you, Rakhi.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks for a very informative session. Thank you all the participants. Thanks for attending these sessions. And today's session will be like about to end. And yes, tomorrow session will be start from 10 o'clock and we'll meet tomorrow 10 o'clock. All the best. Thank you.